Hey you guys, Irene Lyon here. Now, if you follow me, that's great. Thank you very much. Welcome. If you are new to me, welcome as well. One of the things I do often is I hang out in my community on Facebook called Healthy Nervous System Revolution. And there's a lot of great questions in there and I answer them usually via typing, but sometimes via video. And sometimes when one of the questions is one of those questions that I get a lot, I will put this up onto YouTube. So this is what this video is. The question came from someone who asked about my opinion on introverts and extroverts because she saw somewhere, I'm not sure where, that I really don't believe in such a concept. And the second question had to do with how a person is to find cellular safety in their biology when they are living in an abusive relationship in a toxic environment. So here are my answers. In terms of introverts, extroverts, I just don't like this concept because it classifies people, kind of like I'm a Scorpio and you're a Libra or whatever, and therefore because I'm that sign, this is the way I'm supposed to be. So that's kind of one very simple way of putting it. Also, it depends. It's like, is the introversion just some introversion quotes, just someone who really enjoys being in their own personal body space and enjoys things that are more quiet, like art and reading and, you know, going for walks in the park and that kind of thing, versus someone who, likes to play sports and go out to parties and bars, etc. What I've seen or what I've come to realize is that each person is unique, and each human, when healthy, has an entire spectrum of moments when they need downtime, moments when they just want to connect with one person individually, moments when they just want to sit and read a book, but also moments when they want to go out and have dinner with a bunch of people, or you know, go rock climbing with friends, or go on a cruise, or you know, just be a little more out there. I think that if we're always out there, always, you know, in this high energy state, we burn out because there is no rejuvenation time, versus someone who is more internal, who never has any, you know, interactions with other humans. I mean, I'm going to assume some humans, but, you know, is very limited, and therefore they limit their capacity to expand and grow. Now, when there's been various forms of trauma, let's just say, you know, the more severe kinds, early trauma, abuse, neglect, that kind of thing, there is a tendency for those people to fall in one of those categories quite strongly. So either these people get really insular and, you know, more, we would say, things like depressive symptoms, they're unwell, they have no energy, they are in what we would call this shutdown state of the nervous system, where they actually just can't get out. That's very different than a person who just really enjoys solo time. And then there are some people that have very traumatic pasts who go the different route, and they end up being like crazy outgoing, crazy driven. I'm thinking of someone like Tony Robbins right now, the personal development guru, who doesn't like to be called a guru, but he, you know, he came from, if you look up his story, some pretty severe early trauma. And he kind of said, screw you, you know, history, past, I'm going to prove that I can be the best in all this. And he's gone the extrovert path. However, you know, and knowing some of his history and following him, his health isn't the best. And he's talked about this openly recently, because I honestly believe that drive has just, it's been eating at him, and his system now can't keep up. So for me, bottom line is it's a spectrum, and, you know, we need to find the balance that is unique for us. And we also need to know, are we doing certain things, certain habits, overgiving, for example, or forgiving is one big one because we're trying to compensate, we're trying to get praise, or are we not giving anything because we're afraid we're going to get hurt? Those are just like two examples that, you know, that isn't just all of them. The second question you have is about cellular safety. The thing with this, you ask, please advise best practice on how to support healthy nervous systems in individuals who continue to live with abusive relationships or environments. So the quick and dirty answer to that is you can't promote cellular safety when there is a threat in the environment. Even when a person is no longer in a threatening situation, their physiology, if they don't do the appropriate nervous system regulation work, their physiology will still sense that every single human being is a threat. My husband Seth can speak to this. It isn't until really the last sort of 3-4 years that he has finally felt safe with me, a safe person, right, that he wants to be with. He's chosen to be with me in a safe environment, in a safe country. He even moved from Canada, or from the United States to Canada, you know, like lots of safety, and yet his physiology was still, the radar was such that it is, the world is unsafe and I have to be careful. So when a person is in an abusive situation, they will not find safety. So what they need to do is they need to find resources. They need to pretty much live in a world where their resources, meaning connections with people from the outside world, a hobby, a practice, this is where prayer and spirituality will save people in such situations. They have to have resources and support so that they can at least control their reactions to the unsafe environment. The trouble with this is that if this individual stays in this situation over time, their stress physiology will eventually, it'll win and they'll get sick. This is why a lot of people in abusive relationships have some form of chronic illness, mental illness, or inability to keep a job, have any kind of vigor or motivation, because they're literally being drained by this situation that is not safe. All of their energy is going to preservation of their internal physiology. So I know that for some, they just can't leave such environments. I get that. So for this sort of person, resources, learning, the tricky thing, so here's the caveat to that, is that there is sometimes ignorance is bliss, because when you open up this world of what trauma is and what not being safe is, it's like you are then literally realizing that you are swimming in toxic water, as opposed to being that fish that doesn't even know they're in water. Obviously, in the end, stuff will happen. This person will become unwell, but they just sort of they're ignorant to it. It's kind of like being in the Matrix. If you think of that movie, The Matrix, with Keanu Reeves, you're living in this situation where you don't even know that there's another side. There's another world on the other side. And then as soon as you know that it exists, it is a shock. And that's why in that movie, you know, there was one of the people that wanted to go back. He didn't want to stay in the reality because it was too painful. It was too much to see what was really going on.
Then we have a deal.
I don't want to remember nothing. Nothing.
So this is a judgment call on your part or on the person who is in this situation. As I said, sometimes ignorance is bliss. If you just know that it's not going to be possible, and or adding resources to the person's repertoire so they can find some internal anchor to keep them sane and keep them moving forward and having some form of hope. But this is not an easy question for me, because I've seen it. My clients who are not living in supportive environments with partners who are willing to go through their shit and maybe see someone getting triggered a lot, and that partner that can stay there consistently and not be abusive verbally, not walk out of the room, ignore the person. It takes a lot of strength for a partner to withstand that and stay with it. They have to be pretty damn healthy themselves to be in that and be very committed. And I don't see a lot of this in the people that I see that have chronic health problems. They're living, or they're in a job that is just sucking them dry, or they have family that they can't break free of because there's this guilt trip being laid on them. And these people don't survive. Either they don't survive spiritually, emotionally, or physically. Their systems just break down and their systems can't handle it. So there's my answer to this question, extrovert, introvert, and what it's like, you know, how do you restore cellular safety when you're living in an abusive environment? I hope that's been useful. Obviously comment below and have a good rest of your evening. Take very good care. Bye for now. Hey guys, Irene here. So how did you like that Q&A session? Was it useful, helpful? Did you disagree with me? Did you agree with me? Whichever it is, I would love to hear from you. Leave a comment, ask a question. Let's get this conversation going even deeper. And if you want to be part of this Facebook group that I mentioned, head over to Facebook and look up Healthy Nervous System Revolution. Healthy Nervous System Revolution. You will find me there. Just ask to join. I will put you in the group, and then you can introduce yourself and be part of this amazing group of people. I think there's like 4,000 of us so far. Very supportive community. And if you want to get more of these videos, which I hope you do, make sure you subscribe to this YouTube channel, and you will see me in your inbox maybe once a week, even more. Take very good care. Bye for now.